many patients are overwhelmed with the different types and classes of treatment. When is it time to treat CLL and what are the options?
So I boil down the criteria to when you need to treat your CLL to two main categories. One category is that the disease is progressing quickly, and the other category is the disease is causing problems of some kind or getting ready to cause problems of some kind. Those are kind of the broad categories that we think about when it's time to start treatment for CLL. Now, the groups that research CLL have put out various sets of criteria that help guide physicians about when it's time to start treatment. And some of those more specific criteria include items like symptoms. So symptoms are a very important part of that decision-making process. And the same symptoms that we mentioned, the B symptoms, fevers, chills, night sweats, weight loss that's unintentional, or lymph nodes that you can feel, those would potentially be reasons that your doctor would want to start you on CLL therapy. Mm-hmm. But the CLL can cause issues even in a patient who is not necessarily having symptoms. So one of the most common ways that CLL can cause issues is the CLL cells can cause your other blood cells, your normal blood cells, to be low in number. There are several ways that the CLL cells can do this. One of the most common ways is that the CLL cells, which are often circulating through your bloodstream, can also collect or overrun the bone marrow. And if you think about it, the bone marrow is the factory that makes all of your blood cells. So when there are too many CLL cells in the bone marrow, they can crowd out the normal blood cells, like red blood cells or platelets. So when red blood cells or platelets get low beneath certain thresholds, that's a reason to start CLL therapy. CLL cells can collect in other areas, including the spleen. And if you remember, the spleen is a lymphoid organ that sits on the left side of your body that is right below the stomach. And so if CLL cells collect in the spleen, they can cause it to be too big. It can press on the stomach. It can make it so you feel full, even if you haven't eaten a full meal. That's something we call early satiety. It can be uncomfortable, causing some abdominal pain. And if the spleen gets really, really big, it can cause it to not be able to do its normal job, which is to filter out the normal blood cells like it does every day. And so that would be a reason to start therapy as well. And then the last category that I would think about is in CLL, we have lots of CLL cells that are circulating in the blood that we can check with a routine blood count. And the absolute number of CLL cells is not as important as how fast that number is growing. Mm-hmm. So your physician will track how fast that number of CLL cells is doubling. And if you meet criteria for what we call rapid doubling time, which is usually thought of as less than 12 months, but certainly less than 6 months. So if your count goes from 30,000 to 60,000 in under 6 months, then it may be time for you to start thinking about therapy.
Right. Dr. Koff, would you briefly review the treatment classes?
So for first-line treatment, we have two main treatment classes that we think about at this time. The first is called BTK inhibitors, which is Bruton's tyrosine kinase inhibitors. And these are oral medications, so medications that you take by mouth. And the most well-studied of these is called ibrutinib. We typically prescribe ibrutinib by itself. There are other BTK inhibitors that we are also now using in this space. One of them is called acalabrutinib, and that is often given with an IV monoclonal antibody called obinutuzumab. The other main class of drugs that we consider for first-line treatment of CLL is the BCL2 inhibitors, Right now, there's only one BCL2 inhibitor that's approved for CLL in frontline, and it's called venetoclax. Usually, this drug is also given in the frontline with an anti-CD20 monoclonal antibody. So the venetoclax itself is a pill that you take, and the monoclonal antibody is either an IV or a subcutaneous infusion.
Where do clinical trials fit into CLL treatment?
So clinical trials are part of the reason, a big part of the reason, that we've been able to make so much progress in how we treat CLL over the past few years. Clinical trials are how we figure out what treatments work for CLL, how patients feel on them, what sort of adverse events or side effects they have on individual treatments, and which treatments do better for keeping CLL symptoms under control, keeping disease under control, and allowing patients to live longer and have a higher quality of life with their disease.
Are there any other options available for CLL patients?
So there are other options. A clinical trial, if that is available to you as a patient, is nearly always a good thing to consider if you have CLL, because the vast majority of patients will not be cured by their treatment for CLL, meaning that even though the treatments we have usually work for a very long time in most patients, ultimately the CLL will at some point, perhaps years down the road, progress and need another therapy. For that reason, we know we can do better. And we are hoping that the next clinical trial is going to lead to that discovery of a new agent or a new combination of agents that will allow patients to live longer with a better quality of life with CLL. Mm-hmm. So that's always a good option to consider. Mm-hmm.